Doctors who treat infectious disease fear one thing above all others: antibiotic resistance. Since the 1930s, when drugs to kill bacteria first came into widespread use, pathogens have been hard at work evolving the ability to resist those drugs. Today, of 19 classes of antibiotics that once could easily wipe out Staphylococcus aureus infections, only a very few, among them teicoplanin and vancomycin, are still fully effective. And recently, evidence has emerged suggesting that the latest round of resistant staph bacteria are able to withstand even these drugs of last resort.
In the United States, per annum, one can assign about 18 to 19,000 mortalities in hospitals to infections by this MRSA clones. So this is almost identical to the current lethality of AIDS in the United States.
Alexander Tomas and his colleagues at Rockefeller University are working to understand how relatively harmless staph bacteria, the same bug that grows harmlessly in the noses of about a third of us, acquire the mutations needed to become the deadly strain known as MRSA, multi-resistant Staphylococcus aureus.
Out of literally thousands of these MRSA strains, you can identify, if you go with molecular fingerprints, you realize that about six so-called clones are responsible for 80% of all MRSA disease all over the world.
A few years ago, Tomas's group was the first to track the evolution of one of these MRSA clones, known as the New York Japan clone, in a single patient as he was undergoing antibiotic therapy. By sequencing the bacteria's genome several times over the course of the patient's disease, the researchers pinpointed specific mutations that bestowed the bug with its ability to resist antibiotics. Now, the scope has been broadened in order to understand how another clone, the Brazilian clone, has evolved not only through the course of a single infection in a patient, but as it jumps from patient to patient, leaping from one hospital room to another, and ultimately from one continent to another.
From the six pandemic clones, the most widespread is the Brazilian clone. And what we wanted to understand was how this clone evolved in time and in space.
In Tomás's laboratory in New York City, and in his collaborator's laboratory in Portugal, there are over 50,000 samples of staph bacteria collected from a period of decades from hospitals and clinics all over the world. The samples are stored in freezers kept at minus 70 degrees Celsius, and the scientists keep careful track of where they came from, when they were collected, and the details of the patient's diseases. De Lancaster and her colleagues provided samples from this large collection, known as the SEMNET collection, representing several countries and more than 20 years, to their collaborators at the Sanger Institute in the UK, who then sequenced the staph bacteria's genomes. The resulting data allows the scientists to plot the spread of drug-resistant bacteria between hospitals and across national borders, and even track how quickly mutations in the bacteria appear.
When the sequencing was done, it was found that we could distinguish three main subgroups. They call it clades. One was the European clade, the other was the South American clade, and the other was the Asian clade. This has very important implications in public health in terms of infection control, because you can really, if you sequence, to know from where a patient got the isolate.
Because it gives officials the ability to trace transmission pathways with unprecedented precision, the technology offers the potential for doctors to target their interventions with far greater accuracy in the event of an epidemic. What's more, the work sheds light on the fundamental processes of evolution in MRSA bacteria, suggesting how the acquisition of mutations, at the rate of about one every 6 weeks, helps the bacteria thrive and spread.
I think sooner or later you'll understand what epidemicity means. What is the mysterious property of some clones but not the others? Why they are so successful in causing disease, and this is just a minority. This must be written in the genetic code of this bacteria. But to figure it out, you need to pair up the sequencing methodology with a good molecular epidemiology.